it's kind of turned into the greatest adventure of all time. What I'm trying to do in a desperate way is to show the world that we're just about to lose the last little gem in the African continent. And if we don't do something now, if we don't do it today, we can forget about it.
The whole exercise is not only to document the wildlife and show that it needs to be saved, but to try to show a traditional Africa with dignity.
Hello. Hello. Ho.
I don't know who was more nervous, me or her. A lot of times they looked at me and said, we can't do this. We can't. It's impossible.
It's like,
You just say, we have to go forward. We're too far, you know, because we're already beyond the point of no return.
It's like a total religious experience. No other way to describe it.
Published three stories in the magazine, five by the end of it.
What the Megatransect did was not only unique, but it was seen as impossible. The project inspired me to create Pristine Seas. It took an obsessed conservationist, a genius photographer, brilliant writer, and the vision of a president to make this happen. And I said to myself, aha, this is what I want to do in the ocean.
We'd spent the most difficult months of our lives together, and we had endured incredible hardships and survived.
Yeah, is it worth it? Hell yeah.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the stage National Geographic's President and CEO, Gary Nell.
Thank you, everyone. Good evening. You're in for an incredibly special event tonight. This is really a family gathering, and it's also the kickoff of our 2018 photography seminar. You're surrounded tonight in the audience by some of the great photographers of the world. If you tap on the person next to you, they're bound to be a photographer. I am as well, and with my fancy phone, but we do what we can. We're an incredible gathering of photographers and storytellers and educators and scientists all connecting around campus this week. It's an annual event about the power of photography. It's the chance once a year for us to gather and come together with this incredible community to talk about the hallmark of a legacy at National Geographic for well over a century. You know, the photography was put into the magazine about 100 years ago thanks to Alexander Graham Bell and his son-in-law, Bert Grosvenor, who was Gil Grosvenor's grandfather, for those of you who know Gil. And there was a big debate on the Board of Trustees at the time, and two board members quit because they thought it would dumb down the magazine. So, which shows you don't always need to listen to the Board of Trustees. Now, I say that with some courage because my chairman, our chairman of the board here tonight, who actually I do listen to and who is a great counsel for the National Geographic Society and a great leader for our board, Gene Case is here tonight. Welcome. So So tonight we have an unparalleled program in store for you. This commemorates a project that really revolutionized, as this film showed, the way National Geographic goes about its work and thinks about its role in the conservation space. It's a chance to recognize an incredible person, our explorer in residence and conservationist, Dr. Mike Fay, and the incredible team from Gabon that he assembled for an unprecedented expedition called the Megatransect. Mike and the team led the National Geographic historic undertaking nearly two decades ago. And we're so fortunate tonight that they have invited along, and he invited along at the time for that very journey, our really in-house photographer of the decades, and that's none other than Nick Nichols, who was able to document this journey with stunning photos, many of which you can see across the courtyard here at this brilliantly curated show that the Philadelphia Museum of Art put together, which broke records in Philadelphia and has been here now having record crowds as well. Of course, he's sharing the campus with Jesus, which helps at the time. So, but we think it's a good pairing, don't you? So, how do we bring someone else to the table who can bring these two brilliant people together and bring out their stories? And that's none other than I think probably the best science journalist around today, and that's David Quammen. David, welcome. This evening we're going to get to relive this adventure. You're going to hear about the emotion and the triumphant legacy of this incredible project that has inspired so many at National Geographic. But first, before we get underway, I also wanted to welcome a few very special people here tonight. Two senators will be here shortly. I think they have votes up on the Hill. Senator Sheldon Whitehouse from Rhode Island, Senator, is coming shortly. And Senator Chris Coons from Delaware, Congressman Mark Sanford from South Carolina, and former Congressman John Tanner from Tennessee, and Bill Archer and his wife Sharon from Texas. Welcome to National Geographic. It's also my distinct honor to welcome the U.S. ambassadorial nominee to the Gabonese Republic and the Republic of Sao Tome and Principe, Mr. Joel Dannies. Joel, welcome. As well as his wife, Karen, and their daughter, Blair. So thank you for being here. Mr. Dannies, ambassador designate, we're so pleased to have your family here tonight. And you join us in celebrating this monumental occasion. It's the real testament to the power of collaboration with the government and people of Gabon. And as you take on your new post, assuming the two senators vote for you, which we're relatively confident they will, we will have your championship, I think, for some of the work and the importance of conservation that so much of us depend on here. And speaking of conservation, there's two giant heroes in the house tonight. One is also celebrating an anniversary, the 20th anniversary of the Sustainable Seas Program, and that's her deepness herself, Dr. Sylvia Earle. Sylvia. And the person who, as you've seen and heard, got his inspiration from Mike and his journey and Nick's connection around storytelling, also an explorer in residence who's done a brilliant job helping to protect over 5 million square kilometers of our oceans with his pristine seas project, Dr. Enrique Sala, everyone. Finally, we're delighted to have partners at the Wildlife Conservation Society with us this evening. WCS is a world leader in conservation and was absolutely integral to the co-sponsoring Mike's efforts and continues to support his work today. Supporting him back throughout the expedition, WCS is committed to ongoing conservation efforts in Gabon and remains active on the ground there today. So please, from the WCS, please join me in welcoming to the stage the Executive Vice President for Conservation and Science, John Robinson. John?
Thank you, Gary. I want to thank the National Geographic Society for recognizing this 20th year anniversary of the Megatransect. And it's worth thinking a little bit about 20 years, because so much has happened over the last 20 years in conservation in Central Africa. The area has opened up. Wildlife and wild lands are under probably more threat now than they were certainly 20 years ago. Political instability has washed in from the Sahel. Extractive industries have been taking wood and minerals out of the area. The forest estate has been degraded and broken up. Forest elephant populations have fallen by 60% over the last 20 years. So we're looking at an area which is under a lot of conservation threat. At the same time, the response has been very aggressive in terms of conservation. And the countries of the forested Francophone region in Central Africa have really put a lot of effort into conservation, established parks and protected areas, built the capacity in a way that we would not have thought possible. And what the Megatransect did 20 years ago was make the world aware of the great wilderness of Central Africa and our collective obligation to conserve it. Mike came up with the idea of the Megatransect. Walk across the Congo Basin from northern Congo to the coast, looking at the forest from looking within the forest, looking from the forest out rather than what we normally do, which is look at the forest from the outside. And when Mike first broached this idea with me, I thought it was daft. The walk itself was going to be hugely challenging, crossing these vast areas of swamp forest, which were recognized to be absolutely impenetrable. There were few trails. Most of them they were animal trails. The logistics were just stupendously difficult. And it was going to take a long time. And as we know, that walk was to last for 15 months. And my core question was, and why do we want to do this? What is it going to do for scientific knowledge? What is it going to do for conservation? But the power of the idea took hold, and Mike's expression of that idea prevailed. Because the Megatransect has got the power to communicate. Ultimately, the idea just takes your breath away. And Nick Nichols's evocative photographs, David Quammen's wonderful words, really managed to capture the wild areas, the wildlife, and the forest people of the region. And the Megatransect happened. The logistics worked, at least a good bit of the time. Mike and his team got through the Green Abyss and eventually to the coast. No one killed anyone, which was a consideration. Many exceptional areas for conservation were found. And through it all, National Geographic followed the trek and communicated the trek and what was in Central Africa to the rest of the world. And in many ways put the conservation of Central Africa on the map. And when it was all over, and although for Mike it probably never is totally over, And the images and the words and Mike's presence inspired President Omar Bongo to create that national park system in Gabon. and recruit Lee White from WCS to run it. In 2002, then Secretary of State Colin Powell launched the Congo Basin Partnership. And through the CARPE program of USAID and through US Fish and Wildlife Service, funded the US commitment to conservation in the region. And that has been an incredible commitment and continues to this day. As Gary said, Ambassador Designate to Gabon, Joel Danes, is here with us this evening. And that's a tribute to what we are trying to do in conservation in that part of the world. And so it's very fitting that we celebrate the Megatransect today. The Megatransect was a pivotal event that really made us understand why we wanted to conserve the Central African wilderness, why it was so valuable, and what we needed to do to make it happen. So tonight is a very exciting night. Gary.
Thank you, John, and we're so fortunate to have WCS here tonight, a great partner and do incredible work. I'd like to thank also Edith McBean and Darlene Anderson, Phil Stevenson, Greg and Mary Moga for their support for this and many other projects at the Geographic. Senator Coons, I know you're here, and we welcomed you before, but welcome you in person. Thank you for being here. And I'd also like to thank Nikon for their support tonight and for the week here of great photography. We are ready to go on our journey. And this greatest adventure of all time, as it's been described modestly, was not for the faint of heart, a grueling trek from northeastern Congo to the coast of Gabon, all the while meticulously documented, recorded and measured by this astonishing crew of Gabonese and Nick and Mike, showing off the astonishing biodiversity of the Central African rainforest. And it was a trek that shows the limits we can push ourselves and tests those of human endurance. So, to get us started tonight, I wanted to introduce to you, again, someone who is one of the great science journalists who wrote the entire issue of National Geographic on Yellowstone, which is still being sold in Cody, Wyoming, which is really something. It is a mini book. It was a masterpiece of journalism that won many awards. And David, when we had to explain what was going on in the Okavango River Basin, there was only one person who could get this right, and that was David Quammen. So I'd like to invite to the stage to get our evening started with these incredible heroes and pioneers. Please welcome to the stage Mr. David Quammen. Thank you.
Thank you, thank you. Thank you very much, Gary, and thanks to all of you for being here tonight. It's an important evening, and if we're lucky, fun may break out too. There will be more thank yous. There are a lot of individual thank yous to be said in connection with the Megatransect itself, and those will be said at the end. But to start, it's my privilege tonight to introduce two passionate and important conservationist. One of them happens also to be a scientist, a field ecologist, and the other happens to be a photographer, an artist of seeing and light. But the reason we're here tonight is that they're conservationists. Sometimes I call them the Glimmer Twins. They're not twins, and they're really not, in many ways, all that similar. They don't really need much introduction, but I'll say a few things about each of them that you might not know. Mike Fay grew up in California and then in New Jersey. He was that solitary kid who rides a bike out miles and miles from home goes on adventures, gets into trouble, doesn't get caught, may or may not reappear for dinner. He taught himself fly fishing and tying flies. He learned birds, became an expert birder. He invented dirt bike stunts. And then he went off to college at the University of Arizona, where he studied botany. But not just botany, he also took courses in beekeeping and tractor repair. Always a practical guy and a tech head, as well as an explorer. He first went to Africa in 1977 with the Smithsonian Peace Corps. While he was there, after some time, he completed a doctorate on gorilla ecology. He learned to fly a plane. He did some very ambitious forest walks before the Megatransect. And gradually, he became what he is, which is, in my opinion, the most serious and effective conservationist on the planet. Please welcome Mike Fay. Nick Nichols is an Alabama boy, which is part of the reason he's smiling tonight. He became a photographer by getting drafted in the US Army, and then somehow he persuaded them to hand him a camera instead of a gun. He matured as a photographer, working on outdoor adventure stories for magazines like Rolling Stone and Geo. He climbed El Capitan with a writer friend by ratcheting his way up the world's longest rope. And there are stories about that that we won't tell tonight. He worked in jungles and caves. Then in 1990, he came to National Geographic. Thank goodness for National Geographic. I once asked Nick a question on stage in front of an audience bigger than this one. I said, Nick, photography was invented in 1839. If you'd been born in 1780, what would you have done with your life? And his jaw kind of hung for a few seconds, and then he said, I'd be in prison, I guess. Please welcome Nick Nichols. Let's go to work. Okay. These fellows are going to talk and tell the story of the Megatransect for about 40 minutes, and then we're going to change gears a little bit and talk about now and the future, conservation, what's going on, what needs to go on, for about another 20 minutes. And then we're going to have some thank yous and recognition. And then we'll have a question and answer period of about 15 minutes, if any of you are still here. So briefly, what's the backstory on how you two cooked up the Megatransect and persuaded National Geographic and WCS and John Robinson to let you do it?
Well, I guess the kind of defining moment was the war that broke out in northern Congo in 1997. And instead of going to Brazzaville for our kind of supplies and banking and all that, I started to go to Libreville in Gabon with my Cessna, and I started flying over all these places that I hadn't been to before because I concentrated to the east, and I discovered all kinds of amazing, huge, beautiful, virgin forest along the way. And, you know, I'd been working with Nick all those years before, and I had also been walking a lot, and I knew how to navigate, and I knew what to do when you encounter an elephant. I knew that I could do this, so I thought, you know, I think I want to walk all the way from where I work and take that plane trip on foot all the way to the coast of Gabon. So I called up Nick, and he's like, hell yeah, we'll do that, you know?
And, so, wait, let me jump in. He wrote a 45-page proposal. Turned it beautiful, perfect. And I didn't read it. I looked at the cover, and I said, we got to do this to John Fahey and the Bill Allen song.
Yeah, and Nick also said, he said, yeah, and the Geographic just started up this thing they're calling like the Expeditions Council or something like that, and it's like run by this woman, Rebecca Martin, and I'll bet you get all the money for it there, you know? So
yeah.
We wrote to Rebecca, wherever she is, and she's still here, still plugging away. So it's kind of cool that there's a lot of folks here tonight that were around then.
Okay. So you walked for 2,000 miles, 3,000 miles? The number, yeah. You, as you said, yeah. The number
3,700 kilometers, whatever that comes
okay.
to.
Okay. And 456 days, by my count, it was 456 days.
Yeah.
On the, I start to say on the trail, but there was no trail. On the march, 456 days. What was the purpose of the Megatransect?
Well, you know, like you said, I've always been a conservationist ever since I was a little kid. You know, I always, every morning I get up and I think, you know, why are humans doing this? Why are they destroying things they don't need to destroy? We can use things without destroying. Something about me, that's how I wake up every morning, right? So the only thing I know how to do is conservation, and the way I do it is to know the place. You know, you gotta be able to distinguish what really is extremely valuable or something that is kind of irreplaceable and it's gonna disappear forever if you don't do something from, you know, it's like, okay, maybe the Great Plains of the eastern United States where you've got, you know, cornfields as far as the eye can see, you're not gonna get that back. You're not gonna get the buffalo herds back. But you know, I think that in Central Africa, there was this great opportunity. So I said, I'm gonna have to walk the whole thing to really understand what we need to do and where we're gonna go and how we're gonna do it. So that's it, yeah.
When I got a call to be part of this, and Ollie Payne talked to me about it and said, Mike Fay is gonna do this. And I said, yeah, I've heard of Mike Fay. I've read some of his reports. That's good. And then Ollie said, and Nick is gonna photograph it. And I thought, that's good. Nick and I have wanted to work together. And then Ollie said, it's gonna be called the Mega Transect. And I laughed out loud. What's a transect and what's a mega?
Well, we know mega, right? It's like big, like the mega store, you know, like the mega box store. And the transect is a walk that you take usually, or a airplane track you make, or, you know, whatever it is. In science to quantify what's out in nature, you know? So, I mean, that's one form of transect. So when you're walking, every step you take, whatever it is you're quantifying, whether it's trees or animal tracks or dung or encounters with whatever it is, you write it down and you've got your GPS and it's recording exactly where you are, and then you can start looking at trends. So for instance, on the Megatransect, you know, you penetrate a large block of forest and you'll see the curve of elephants go whoop, whoop, as you go back out, right? And then the human sign goes whoop, back up, you know? So if you put all those variables together, you can say, well, this is the core area. You know, you can quantify what you're looking at. So that's a transect.
So we saw on the big map, I think we saw on the big map, the zigzag path, this sinuous path that starts in northeastern Republic of Congo and winds around and winds some more and finally comes to the Atlantic Ocean. What defined that route? Why is that red line so curvy?
Well, you know, the pygmies, they don't always get the direction right, so supposed to go in a straight line, but we didn't. No, actually, what it was before the project, and especially with the airplane, but using a lot of other sources of data, I created this kind of chain of polygons, and polygon is just a space that was defined by human settlements around it, and then everything inside was unsettled. There were no humans inside each of those polygons. And so there were, I think, 13 polygons. And so what I did was I drew a line through that string of polygons that were contiguous that would bring me to the kind of epicenter of every single polygon. And that way you're going from the human side of things farther and farther and farther and getting as deep as you can possibly get into every block of force. So that defined the line.
And those polygons were drawn, the shape that they are and where they were, because that encircled the greatest, richest, least disrupted blocks of Central African forest, right?
Yeah, that was like the creme de la creme. You know, that was everything else was coming in. Humans were gobbling up the forest from both sides, and this was really the largest kind of still virgin stands of forests that were left in all of Central Africa, not just to the western part, but the entire basin.
So, on the walk, I walked behind you for 50 or 60 days, I think.
53 days, I think.
53 days, okay. And on those days, we'd start walking at first light, and on a compass line, if we're lucky, an elephant trail, and Nick would or would not be with us. He might be someplace else in the forest, and we'll get to that, what you were up to. And you would walk about 30 paces and stop and see something and start to write a note with a pencil in your write in the rain notebook. And I'd stop because you'd stop. And then the army ants would run up my legs and start to bite me and sting me while you made a note into this write in the rain notebook. And you did that with and without our company, month after month after month after month. There were dozens and dozens and dozens of write in the rain notebooks. What did all of those notes and all of those notebooks add up to? What was the methodology about, and what was the sum of the sum meaning of the harvest of data?
Well, if you can imagine, you know, you're take one polygon. So you start out and you walk 10 feet into the forest and you're usually on a human trail, you know, so or some human kind of, you know, impacted forest. And so you write down, you know, cigarette pack, 12-gauge shotgun shell, a fireplace, a snare, you know, all these things that you're encountering. And for the first two or three days, no wildlife, no sign of wildlife, no vocalizations of any monkeys or no diker sign, not a single track of wildlife. And as the days go on, you all of a sudden you hear that first monkey, you know? So, and again, you're recording the location every 20 seconds. So all of a sudden there's that first monkey you hear. You know, and it's like, okay, that, and you know what species it is because you know all the vocalizations of all the monkeys, and you write it down. And so you get the first hit on monkeys, you know, and then as the days go on, you get 20 or 30 hits of monkeys per day, and 20 hits of dikers per day, and 5 elephant encounters, and 2 gorilla encounters, and 4 chimpanzee nests, and whatever it is, and you're recording all that. So like I say, you put that all in a graph, you know, you put it in a database, and then you can see, okay, gorilla. But you get to Menkebe Forest, which was one of the biggest blocks left in Africa. It was over 3 million hectares at that point, huge area. And you walk from the edge all the way to the epicenter in what is good gorilla habitat, and there's no gorillas, you know. So you'll see in that database, it's like flatline gorilla all the way across. and you think, God, that's, no one knew that, you know, and what happened? Well, Ebola hit there, and it killed all the gorillas. Didn't hit kill all the chimps, but it killed all the gorillas. So, you know, no one knew that, but that data set's going to tell you that, you know, and there's no discussion about it. It's real. It's data, you know. So that's the coherent explanation for the madness, you know, and the pygmies watching you every day, like this guy's crazy, you know. But.
So speaking of the pygmies, Valerie, would you back up three slides, please? Can you do that? Yes.
Oh, yeah.
Who are these gentlemen?
That's the A team.
That's the Congo team.
Yeah, so, you know, where we started the Megatransect was a place I worked for 10 years. So a lot of these methodologies and you know, exploring an area and doing a transect across it and proposing a national park and creating a national park, all those things I'd already done before the Megatransect. And these guys are all pygmies except one who we worked with and I worked with for years in northern Congo. And these guys are like, you know, the last of the Mohicans kind of thing. They're the guys who really knew the forest. They could climb trees like nothing, you know, big old trees that just go boom, 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 right up. They knew every little, you know, they'd go along and they'd pick something up, you know, and they'd be looking at it, and then they'd look up and there's bees up there, you know, and that's honey, you know. So they knew everything. And so, you know, who better to go through the forest with? But I always dreamed too of saying, wow, you know, one day I'd love to just head off into the woods with these guys.
So these guys weren't just walking along with you, though.
What's that?
These guys weren't just walking along.
Well, you know, they were instructing me, I would say, the whole way. You know, that's what's cool about pygmies. I always say I didn't write my PhD. You know, two pygmies did, because I walk through the forest all day, and the guy says, okay, I know you can't see anything, but the gorilla was sitting here, and it ate that plant, and it walked over there, and then it ate that, and then it climbed up the tree, and I write it all down, right? And I get the PhD, and they didn't. You know? But yeah, these guys, they're something else.
One fellow isn't there from the beginning, right? Endokanda.
Yeah.
So tell us, both of you maybe, or tell us about Endokanda. Who was he?
Well, Endokanda was a really old pygmy.
He was in the first slide.
He was probably in his 60s, which for a pygmy in that area was ancient. You know, it's like 90 to 100 of, you know, kind of Washington D.C. inhabitants, and so he had seen things that none of that newer generation had ever seen. You know, they were people who spent 95% of their time in the forest. They were afraid of other people. But they knew the forest like nobody else. So when we were going to do the transect, Endokanda was always kind of just an older pygmy that would work for us once in a while, but he wasn't. But he came to me and said, "I want to go on this walk, you know, because that's going to be my last chance to ever go in the forest, you know." And I knew he wasn't going to make it. You know, I said, "Endokanda, you're going to die on that trail. You know, there's just no way you can go. But come, you know, come." And what was really cool is when we started the transect, and it was day one, first 10 steps, and Endokanda gets to the edge of the forest, and he takes his shirt off, and he puts like paint on his face, and then pew, and then like 4 months later, he's dead. He died, and it wasn't really because of the transect, but he didn't die brokenhearted. You know, he died having done what he wanted to do as the last thing in his life. So it was pretty cool.
Valerie, go ahead and roll on, please. So Nick, 15 months, except for the short period when you were sick, you were out there too,
yeah,
all this time, not necessarily walking with Mike. When you weren't with Mike on the march, where were you and what were you doing?
I was sitting in that clearing. Whoa. I laid siege, and I would sit with a camera by myself often and try to capture the things that could come in front of the camera. Because walking, when I walked with Mike, I photographed Mike and the pygmies. I didn't carry a camera for wildlife photography. When I tried to do that, the first leg, it just broke the expedition down. It was like there were too many people. And then I decided, well, I won't do that anymore. And that's something that I want to share with the audience is you can't change what you've come to document. So you've got to be a fly on the wall. And oftentimes the photographers are very demanding and cause a lot of disruption.
I've heard that.
You've heard that. And I decided I wouldn't do that. And so it made a big change in my life, that moment of decision. From then on, I just became a fly on the wall.
How about the tree stand overlooking the clearings in the Central African forest are called bai, B-A-I, big clearings. And so one of the places where you laid siege was in a tree stand up above a bai. For how long, shooting what?
It was Lokwe bai, and you and Mike had already gone through there. I was supposed to be there when y'all come, and we'd be happy to see each other, but that didn't work out. So I went by myself to that bai. John Brown is camped at the river 2 miles away.
Is Congo or Gabon?
Congo. And so therefore, they would come to my camp every day, or twice a week, to see if I was still alive. But it was me out there watching the gorillas, the hippopotamus, and the elephants and all the things that came to the clearing. And one evening, I go home. Well, it gets dark. 30 gorillas go by me and lay down on the trail. So I've got to go out by them to go home. And No.
Valerie, will you go back one slide, please? Tell us about dynamic photography.
Well, you
or don't.
No. I really want to listen tonight.
Okay. Yeah. Mike.
Yes.
John mentioned the Green Abyss. There was a zone on the map in Congo that you named the Green Abyss. What was it, and what did it take to get through it?
Well, the Green Abyss, this thing was, again, all about kind of human footprint, right? And so you're trying to go through the wildest possible places all the way along, right? And one of those polygons was really in the floodplain of the Congo River, the place where you go from like the alluvial to the alluvial kind of plain, so it's the bottomland of the swamp, of the basin. And it's really just right at the edge of what almost becomes a gigantic lake in the wet season, gigantic lake. And so what happens in forests like that is the tree density goes way down and the ground vegetation goes way up. And you don't know how thick a forest can get until you go to that place, I think. I mean, I couldn't see you and I couldn't see Nick for like 4 months, And a lot of days you'd only make it like, and it was a real problem for water because you'd only make it like 500 yards or 1,000 yards at the max.
And how many hours of cutting?
Like 12 hours, and Mambelame, the pygmy, he looked like Popeye. His arm got like, because he's just like chopping all day, every day. Like I calculate he made millions of cuts with his machete, And And that you don't really have a choice, especially when you're deep in there. It's like you got to get out, right? So we just kept chopping and chopping and chopping and chopping our way all the way through. But it was hell, and you kind of people like to dramatize things, right? But I don't think anybody's ever going to walk through that place again.
Including you?
Yeah, especially me. Especially me. Like, yeah, I should redo the Megatransect. I'm like, yeah, right. Go for it. That ain't going to happen.
So there's another memorable block of forest. And again, John mentioned it, I think, Minkebi Forest. So Nick was there for part of that with you. I was there for part of it. We walked again. You probably know the number of days better than I do, maybe 7 days or something like that. I walked with you. And we saw through this beautiful forest of gorilla habitat, we saw a sign of 994 data points of sign of elephants and zero of gorilla, right?
Yeah.
And I asked you, and you tallied those up at the end of it. So there were no gorillas in that place, presumably because of Ebola, and it was near that Ebola outbreak place on the river, the famous Mayabutu. What's Minkebi like now? What has changed? What has happened in Minkebi?
Well, you know, when we traversed Minkebi, of course, I'd flown over it many times, and the interesting thing about it was not just its vast extent, but it had all these inselbergs, these granite domes in the middle of it, that of course the people with me had never seen. You know, so you're walking for a month, and then like 5 weeks, and I keep telling these guys, you know, because you start hearing the murmurs around the campfire at night, like, this guy's crazy again, he's gonna kill us, you know, it's like, you know, we're gonna die out here, and the volume keeps going up every night, so, and I'd be like, no, you know, another 3 days, we're gonna hit these rocks out in the middle of the forest, you know, and they go above the forest, and there's no trees up there, and a helicopter's gonna land, and they're gonna bring us food, you know? and these guys are like, mm-hmm. Like, but yeah, there were no gorillas, but tons of elephants. What has happened in Kebe in the last 15, 17 years is that that gigantic block of like 3.5 million hectares has been reduced down to about 600,000 hectares, which is the current park. And everything around it has been logged 100%. Not a single large tree that can be exploited is in that forest anymore. It's all gone. And there are thousands and thousands and thousands of kilometers of roads in that forest, and hundreds of bridges, and the population of wildlife there has probably decreased by over 90%. And then we had another problem in Minkebi, which was gold miners. So we got about 7,000 gold miners that came in from West Africa and decided to start exploiting this mine that had been there a long time, but not 7,000 people, a couple hundred people, you know. So we closed that camp down in 2010. And what's happened subsequently is, with ivory exploding once again price-wise in the last 7-10 years, elephant poaching throughout the continent has obviously followed, you know, the price of ivory, i.e. the poaching of elephants has gone exponential. And the forest ivory is much harder than the savanna ivory, so it's sought after. And Gabon, being the last bastion, last stronghold of elephants, of forest elephants on Earth, and Minkebi being close to the Cameroon border, we've had thousands and thousands of elephants killed in Minkebi in the last 7 or 8 years.
Forest elephants. On a slightly lighter note, you clearly love forest elephants, and you loved
to get close to them with your video camera. And I remember one particular day, it was the two of us, and forget who the point man was, and there was a female elephant with a calf about maybe 60 meters away, and you started walking. We were just looking at the Inselbergs, by the way. You started walking slowly toward her and talking to her gently and reassuring her, and she started getting nervous. And you had told me beforehand, whatever you do, don't run from a forest elephant. Don't run from a grizzly bear, yeah, we know. Don't run from a forest elephant either. Worst thing you can do. Okay, you're stepping closer to her. She's getting more agitated. You're stepping still closer. I'm stepping up behind you, getting ready to hide behind your massive 130-pound frame. And finally, she charges, and she comes rushing at us. And when she's about 10 feet away, you throw out your arms and go, yeah! And it stops her. Sometimes that works, I know. It has worked for Ian Douglas Hamilton, too, and then sometimes it hasn't worked for him. But it worked for you that day. Mm-hmm. And she stopped. And she turned and she rattled her tusks against a tree in sort of displaced frustration. And then she turned around and took off. And at this point, I'm kind of behind you. And you turn with your little maniacal smile. And you said to me, I can't exactly say what you said to me, euphemistically, you said with a smile, that's the crucial moment. Run then and you're screwed. So approaching forest elephants, what did you learn about them individually and about the particular forest circumstances that they were in?
Well, part of the methodology, which the pygmy just didn't like, because we always had one point guy, you know, and that's something people shouldn't understand. We had 13 guys, but I would leave the camp every morning with one guy, and he was the point man, you know, and I would walk behind him, and they would cut and walk, and I would say, okay, left, right, and we count stuff, right? And part of the methodology...
What would the other 11 do?
And they would hold back maybe 2 or 3 hours, okay. And then they would follow our trail, because that way... we would be alone, you know, just two people walking through the forest instead of 13 people, because that's going to make a lot of noise and you're not going to see anything, right? So every day we walked alone, unless David or Nick were along, and Nick's 400 porters with his stuff and all that.
I had to do just one thing.
I'm just kidding. So anyway, part of the methodology was... to what I called engage with every elephant. So if we heard an elephant off the trail, usually the pygmies would sneak around, you know, like, oh, got to get around the elephant. But I would say, okay, let's go meet the elephant, because that would tell us, you know, if you meet an elephant, and as soon as they get any hint that there's a human and they book, then you're like poaching in this forest, right? And it's not 100%, but if you do that every single time you encounter an elephant or engage with an elephant, then you can add it to the data set of, you know, this is a pristine forest because when you meet this elephant, that elephant is saying, no, this is my forest. It's not your forest. You know, I've been a few places maybe in my life where I've seen humans and I step lightly there, but now you're in my forest. And so they're gonna charge you, because they're just like, you know, who are you? I'm charging you. And you're gonna get out of my way because this is chez moi, you know? And you learn a lot about human presence and whether that population of elephants is basically kind of naive about the ways of humans and elephant poaching and why they're being targeted and all those things. And elephants are very smart. I mean, they calculate their movements in a very precise way. And it has a lot to do with, you know, I always say there's three things that drive an elephant's presence in the present time. Number one is security. It's not food, it's security. And especially now. Two is food, and then three is sex. you know? And so, you know, if you're challenging every elephant and that one bolts and every elephant you meet for 4 days bolts, then you're like, there's people here. And then you would, of course, find maybe a carcass or shotgun shells or a 458 shell or whatever, and you put that in your database. But what was really incredible is, you know, you walk, like, say, 3 days, 4 days, sometimes 5 days, and then for me, it was like you go behind the human veil, you know, and you're now in the forest where there's no humans, and you know, for at least like 6 weeks or 2 months, you're not going to see another sign of human beings until you get to the other side, you know, and you almost feel like you're secure then, you know, because you're just like in this place where you just know, human being, somebody like me, it's like, you know, you feel good. And even pygmies will say that, you know, they say, ooh, this is a cold forest. And a cold forest means no humans have been there. So wildlife is in abundance, food is in abundance, you know, and so they're always looking for a cold forest, you know. So when you get to that cold forest, you're like, wow, this is amazing, because everything is still there, you know, everything is intact. All the populations are at their highest levels. It's an amazing thing.
I'm not allowed to ask you any questions?
Oh, yeah. Go ahead. I just, you know,
you shot all the wildlife.
Yeah, and I just wanted to hear Mike.
I know. I know. And we all do. We want to hear you a little bit, too.
Okay.
You shot all the wildlife in color, and then you shot the humans, Mike on the march with the guys in black and white. Why?
Well, the black and white and the Leica, which was what I did the black and white with, it allowed me to photograph just the interaction and the concentration of Mike and the men. So that simple. When I walked, I only walked for 6 days here, 6 days there, 2 months. So when I, wow, I don't know. I can't make a sentence. I really can.
Okay. Yeah. Okay, but we get that. We get.
I think what it was Nick went into kind of like war photographer mode when we're on the march, right? Because it's hard, you know. It's like you're walking all day, and his knee was messed up, and you know he was not like fit like we were, because we're walking every day. And I remember asking you once, like, well, after walking all day, and you're looking like, you know, your eyeballs are like this, and you're like, you know, and your arms are like bright red from 6 million scratches. You're looking at me like crazed, and I'm like, David, is this hard? Like, you know, because I'm not, and he's like,
hell yes, it's hard.
So, you know, Nick had to go into like war photography mode. So just have one little Leica, you know, and you're moving with the flow, you know.
Same Leica he was holding when we swam through the Black Lake, and I haven't. There's a particular frame. If you see Sofiano,
yeah, it's coming.
Okay, well, let's pause on Sofiano when we get there. Yeah. But I think it's time to shift gears. I don't know where we are time-wise, whether we're at about 40, because I don't have the count-off clock I thought I was going to
have
here.
There.
Well, no, that's different. That's
not moving.
It's not
frozen in time. We still have.
But can you give me 20 minutes count-off on this clock, and we'll talk about conservation today.
Okay.
But we're not to the end yet.
No, but I think we've been out here about 40 minutes.
Have we?
But I can't tell from this.
No.
Never mind.
Technical
it's
breakdown.
Close
we're still
enough.
You still have 10 minutes and 20. Oh, now we went up. We have now 10 minutes and 29 seconds instead of 28.
No, that's not counting.
I'm just kidding.
That's telling us that it's 10:29 p.m. In eastern Newfoundland right now. That's what it's telling us.
That's what I thought.
So you're still working in Gabon. You have been working in Gabon all this time as a special assistant to President Ali Bongo, right? And You've told Nick and me that you're engaged in three main efforts there now. That's consuming your time and your focus. And that's a special park, very special park, called Wangawange. That's marine protection, and that's holding the line on natural resources. So I want to get you to talk about each of those. First, Wangawange. Tell us a little something about this very special park.
Well, Wangawange wasn't part of the network. Wangawange is a presidential reserve and has been under protection long since the colonial era. And it's changed in form over the years, but when I went back to Gabon in 2010 to start working for the new park agency, it was a sad place because Wangawange was the only real reserve in Gabon for a long time, and it was a fantastic place. It was this amazing landscape of these kind of like whipped cream dunes that were covered in grass, and just grass, no trees. And then you get these gallery forests and full of wildlife. And over the years, I saw Wangawange just wither, and even when you'd go out with the presidential helicopter guys, they'd be like talking about Wangawange in the past tense. Oh yeah, Wangawange was this, Wangawange was that, Wangawange was the, and it was, for them, it was done. It was gone. It was like not even going to exist anymore. So for me, it was like a good test case, but also one of those you had to bring back, we even brought some of the Congress and ex-Congress people in the room tonight, the Archers and the Tanners, to Wangawange back, and I can't even remember what year it was. And that's when we wanted to make a stand. So we told the President Omar Bongo, hey, we gotta get Wangawange back on the map, And so for the last 5 years, I've been using Wangawange also as what I'm calling a model park, saying, we can do this. We can manage parks properly in Gabon. We don't have to manage them poorly. We don't have to constantly be lamenting the disappearance of the wildlife, how many elephant carcasses we're counting every day, ivory going out, buffaloes getting poached, everything. And so for the last 5 years, I've been concentrating on demonstrating that we can bring good management to these places. We can have good financial management. We can bring in infrastructure, build infrastructure, have vehicles that work, guards that are trained, a conservation strategy, a protection strategy, and get this place back up. And the metric is how many animals are there, And we document that frequently with the airplane, and we have doubled the population, doubled and a half the population of forest buffalo in the last 7 years. We've gone from like 1,000 up to like almost 3,500. That's like 3.5 times buffalo, and that's by far and away the largest herd of forest buffalo on Earth. And then the elephant population is growing, and it's happy, and elephants roam there freely, and this place has just re-blossomed. It's spectacular. I mean, it really is one of the most beautiful places on Earth. But now it's reliving again. It's an amazing.
Let's take a look at it.
Okay.
Through the lens of Nathan Williamson, Valerie.
Thank you.
So number two on your list of three efforts is protecting the marine resources, the offshore resources of Gabon. Tell us about that.
So in 2012, scheming with Henrique Sala and his Pristine Seas program, we said, well, we can probably do in Gabon what we did on land at sea. You know, we can create one of Africa's first marine protected area systems, and we can start managing fisheries resources and applying the fisheries law and basically securing Gabonese waters. So we did this expedition up and down the coast and diving, and I even saw some of the divers here because they're having a meeting. So we were all there in Gabon doing all the diving and really discovering amazing things. And at the end of the expedition, we invited the current president, Ali Bongo, on the ship. And it was the Plan B ship of Ted Waite that we were using. And they had a ROV, like one of those drone submarines, right? And when the president came on board, because he's kind of like a techno freak and he plays video games and stuff like that. So we're like, okay, let's have him drive the ROV, you know? And so he drives this ROV and all of a sudden he's like, woo, over this cliff, you know? And we didn't set this up. He was just like, woo, driving this thing. And all of a sudden we come to this place where there's just like all these groupers and snappers and big fish, you know? And the water was crystal clear because it's like 150 meters deep, you know? And he just couldn't believe his eyes. He literally was like, it's like you're in a different world, you know? It's like, for him, he couldn't have even imagined that was Gabon, you know? He's just like, where am I? And he was, you know, just flew in his helicopter 20 minutes off of Libreville, and here he is in this kind of world, you know? So I said, well, you know, we got to do something, and we can do what we did on land at sea. And, you know, much to my kind of like, whoa, what did I just commit myself to? I said, and if you agree to do this, I'll stay and do it. You know, I'll implement the plan, you know, we have the, and so he's like, okay, well, let's do that, you know? And here we are 5 years later, right? And the Marine Protected Network just got signed into law in June. So we now have We have 9 marine parks and 11 marine reserves. But in the meantime, we've also been, you know, I mean, when you look at the pressure that marine resources are under now and all the piracy that is happening around the world, but in Africa in particular, it's not good enough to just publish a piece of paper and say you're done, right? You know, so during those 5 years, we applied the fisheries law. So we reduced trawling of commercial trawlers by 80%, and yet the fish that came to market was the same, because all that fish was just getting exported out of the country. We eliminated pretty much pirate fishing coming into Gabon. We started really controlling artisanal fisheries. And what's amazing is people are now catching a lot more fish today than they were 5 years ago, and yet we're restricting fishing, right? And so you can have your cake and eat it too. And that's the whole thing about conservation. If you don't manage resources, you're going to lose them. You know, you have to manage them, and creating reserves, especially on paper, is not good enough. You have to look at the entire system. So you need those anchors, those special places to be protected, and that's what we did with the marine protected area system, and now we're implementing that. But at the same time, we've pretty much secured the waters and the fish of Gabon.
So securing the resources, securing the waters and the fish. More broadly, your point 3 is holding the line, securing the resources, intelligence, enforcement, protection. We're going to see another video from Nathan. Set it up a little bit and tell us what we're going to see.
Well, you know, when you are in a country like Gabon, and you think, okay, this country lives 99% on the exploitation of natural resources. And they don't have a great plan to transition that economy to a service economy or an industrial economy, and competing with the Asians is going to be very difficult anyway. So, yeah, maybe you can do agriculture, maybe you can do some other things, but keeping the flow of natural resources and making money from them is essential for the Gabonese economy and for the Gabonese people. And if you let every Tom, Dick, and Harry on earth come, and I always, you know, I say a lot to the Gabonese, what's happening is, you know, these guys are coming, and they take your wallet out of your pocket, and they look through it, and they say, oh, here's a fiver, you know. Here you go.
Okay.
And you say, thank you, you know? It's like, I don't understand that. Why would, he just took your whole wallet and he gave you $5 back and you say, thank you. You should lock him up, you know? You should not allow this to happen. So we've been doing a lot of that in the last, you know, many years. And, you know, you get caught fishing illegally in Gabon, we're gonna take your wallet out of your pocket, and we're going to say thank you, you know? And that's what we're going to see just now.
Depuis des dizaines d'années, notre pays s'est vu pillé. Vous savez, là nous parlons de sommes d'argent vraiment colossales. Hein, nous parlons de milliards et milliards de francs CFA. C'est des prédateurs. Ils vont venir au Gabon, ils vont piller tout ce qu'ils auront à prendre au Gabon, et après ils iront dans notre pays. C'est comme ça que ça marche. Ça me fait vraiment mal de voir ce qu'on entend de faire de la forêt gabonaise.
faut voir ça à échelle planétaire. L'Amazonie, il ne reste plus grand-chose. Le bassin du Congo est la dernière grande forêt qui reste. Et on est encore en train de la détruire à vitesse grand V.
Dans moins de 10 ans, il risque de ne plus avoir d'éléphants au Gabon. Aujourd'hui, par ce pillage, nous sommes passés d'un Gabon où il y avait une pauvreté à la misère. Aujourd'hui, nous parlons de misère. Et ce qui est bien, on peut encore tout arranger. Et c'est pour ça qu'il faut encore plus se battre. La première fois que j'ai vu Mike Fay, le docteur Mike Fay, c'était sur une page d'un magazine National Geographic. J'étais encore au lycée. Pour moi, c'est un des pères de la conservation dans le monde, et au Gabon en particulier. Et je me considère comme un de ses disciples. Et vraiment, et j'espère que je pourrai être un de ses héritiers et faire perdurer tout ce savoir là qu'il a et toute cette volonté de sauver la biodiversité, notamment au Gabon. Alors c'est vrai que son caractère est un peu spécial, mais chacun de nous a son caractère, il n'y a pas de problème.
Good man.
Pour nous, c'est un papa. Et des gens comme le docteur Mike Fay ou le professeur Lee White et d'autres, hein, nous ont aidés, nous Gabonais, à ouvrir les yeux. Et je pense qu'aujourd'hui, il est temps que les Gabonais eux-mêmes se prennent en charge. J'ai l'honneur de faire partie de cette nouvelle génération-là. Des fois, on a des petits coups de lumière. Mais de voir de temps en temps un animal qui se déplace en bonne santé, qui vit en forêt, ou de voir les enfants qui sourient. Quand moi j'amène mes enfants voir les éléphants ou les gorilles, voir leur regard, ça redonne... Il n'y a pas plus fort, quoi. Il n'y a pas plus fort. Donc c'est ça qui... C'est cette force-là, invisible, qui fait ça.
So we obviously need a team in Gabon, and I've had the privilege to have had the opportunity to handpick people that I have seen over the years who really care and who have their country at heart. And we have two of those guys here tonight with us, and I'd like them to stand up.
Hubert.
So Hubert, who you saw on the film, is the leader, I guess, you'd say, of the crack troops for the Park Service. And he also leads the intelligence unit, which is quite sophisticated. And we work with a lot of external intelligence agencies because we're dealing with real mafias. We're dealing with people that are stealing hundreds of millions of dollars worth of things from Gabon. And we need to have sophisticated means to protect our resources. And Hubert is the leader of that charge. But Alain is the guy behind the scenes. And as you can see, he commands respect. So he is the man who makes everything happen logistically. Every army needs its logistics, right? And it's more important than the soldiers fighting on the ground, really, because if they don't have bullets and they don't have gas and they don't have vehicles and they don't have all the things they need, they're not going to go anywhere and they're not going to win any fights. So Mr. Alain is the man who makes all of that happen every day, 24/7, pretty much.
Final question, at least final question from me, and then you all will have a chance. In 50 or 100 years, Mike, there are going to be 9 billion people on this planet, at least, maybe 11 billion. The odds against saving things like this seem so great against. What can actually be saved for the long term in Gabon, and how? And is what works in Gabon capable of working anywhere else?
Well, you know, you always have to be, you have to have a missionary mentality, right? You have to say to yourself every morning, someday humans will recognize that leaving scorched earth anywhere you go is not beneficial to humans. It's not beneficial to anything else, but it's also not beneficial for humans. We need water, we need soil, we need plants, we need animals, we need all these things to survive. We need oxygen, we need... So, you know, you think, okay, well, maybe... And I just heard a speech by the CEO of Daimler-Benz who was talking about the world in 50 years, you know, and he was saying, energy will be free because it's going to all be renewable, 100%. And this is the CEO of a major automobile, you know, company. And he's saying, every vehicle is going to be electric, you know, on Earth. And you know, no person will own one because it's going to all be kind of, and no one's going to drive one, you know. And so you imagine this world of, you know, maybe humans do actually get beyond this kind of stage in our existence that we kind of just use hunting and gathering techniques that we had maybe 100,000 years ago in the present, but times 9 billion. That doesn't work. That can't work, right? And we know that. But maybe there is a different kind of way humans can live that we can actually maintain our water and our soils and our forests and our wildlife and productivity of this planet and have 9 billion people. But we need to do something, right? But in the meantime, it's kind of like Noah's Ark. You know, you gotta try to maintain or retain as much of it as you possibly can, as much as the natural evolutionary products out there and as much of natural ecosystems as you can. Because if you don't, you're starting from nothing. And the evolutionary process took billions of years, right? So that would be stupid to just get rid of all that, right? It would be like Microsoft throwing away all of the knowledge they have about ones and zeros and starting back with, you know, trying to scratch ones and twos in the sand, you know, and inventing numerals and inventing mathematics again. It wouldn't be smart to do that, right? They're never going to do that. So, you know, you hope that at some time that those two things will cross and that humans will learn how to live on the planet in a sustainable way. And if you fight long enough, maybe those things, so maybe all those trees that Uber is saving now from getting just raped and pillaged by people, you know, maybe we'll have mahoganies in the future, and maybe we'll have rosewood in the future, and maybe we'll have, you know, all those things that people like to use. They enjoy them, even ivory in the future, you know, all those things that we could very easily lose, you know. So I think that's what you have to hope for. That's all.
Thank you for saying something that's hopeful and cogent. And I think that's a good place to stop. There are more thank yous, a lot more thank yous, and Nick is going to handle them. Valerie, will you roll again?
Yeah. Stan, please. Dave Morgan and Cricket Sands. All right, right here.
All right.
Robin Freeman. She was National Geographic Television. She was tortured by Mike and I. Dave and Cricket started their research with chimpanzees in the Gua Logo. Still there. Oliver Payne. Kathy Moran. Darlene Anderson. Edith McBean.
Hey.
Yeah. Woo. Nathan Williamson.
All right.
Richard and George Ruggiero.
Where are the Ruggieros?
Where? Ah.
All right.
Woo. Neil Messler. John Brown.
Where's John?
John.
All right.
All right.
Bill Allen.
Or Bill.
Where? Where's Bill?
I don't know.
He may not be here. And then there's someone that can't be here, but Tomo Nishihara.
Tomo.
I got through that.
So, we have some time, if you have some time, and want to ask some questions. I think we've got microphones that will travel around. And please do, and please maybe keep your questions concise as a service to the audience and the other people who have questions. Yeah.
Hi, thank you so much. First, I'd just like to thank Nick for the great presentation when Wild opened a few months back. And if you're in a talkative mood again, we would love to listen to whatever you have to say. So we'll always welcome you here in Washington, D.C. You are so inspiring and funny. So thank you.
Yeah.
Next, to Mike, I'm wondering, for Gabon, it looks like there are now these great parks there, and there's great things to see off the coast. Is there a place for ecotourist dollars? Would that potentially be useful, or should we just keep it untrammeled by visitors?
So did somebody plant you in the audience? We actually have taken over, the Park Service has taken over a lodge in Luango, which is another park that I've been managing, which is also one of the most fantastic places on Earth, which several people in this room have been to, so they can, they're still here, right? So they're not dead. although Edith almost died. But there is this place called Luango Lodge. So if you Google Luango Lodge, L-O-A-N-G-O, Luango Lodge, on the internet, you'll find all you need. And if you go to Luango and experience that place, you'll be a changed person forever. It's one of the most fantastic places. We have habituated gorillas now.
Surfing hippos.
We have whales. We have hippos. We have, gorillas and elephants and chimpanzees and forest hogs and 10 species of monkeys and buffalo and everything you can imagine. So including this wonderful coastline and lots of fish now. Tarpon, if you're a tarpon fisherman, come to Gabon. There are world records caught every day. So Luango Lodge is kind of our demonstration that ecotourism can work too in Gabon, and we hope that you'll all come.
Who else? Here's one.
And then there's one up there.
Okay.
Thanks. Mike, I want to ask you about Menkebi. Because of the Cameroonian and the Congolese borders, it's kind of a metaphor for Gabon in a sense that, do you think you can ring fence these things and keep people out?
Well, it's like any battle or any war. You have to be willing to expend the resources you need to protect what it is or to win that battle, right? And unfortunately, in Gabon, if you look at the amount of money being spent per elephant, for instance, countrywide, it's a very low number. It's a lot lower than Botswana. It's a lot lower than even Tanzania. It's a lot lower than Zambia. It's a lot lower than a lot of places who are successful in protecting their elephants. So if you look at Botswana, spending probably 10 times more money than we're spending, and they've got 10 times more people like Hubert who are good at what they do and are committed and are not corrupt and actually doing that thing. So I think that, and that's why we've kind of looked at Wangawange as a model park. If you do this and 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 you're committed, it'll work. But we just have to do it. So yeah, the challenge in Minkebe is much bigger because we have about 300 kilometers of border with countries that have no more elephants and are exploding in human population. We've got Nigeria, you know, a 17 dugout canoe ride away from Gabonese fish. So, you know, we've got this world coming more and more and faster and faster, and you know, the entire Chinese continent has arrived on the African shores in the last 10 years. The challenges are huge and they're increasing every day. So you have to basically fight fire with fire. You need to have what you need on the ground, or you're going to lose it all. You will. There's no doubt about it.
Hi, gentlemen. Thank you, first of all. Short question. How can I help? I'm not a senator. I'm not a super well-known photographer. I'm not a journalist. I'm not like one of these many amazing people in the room tonight. I'm just a random person who was given a ticket and said, you should go to this because it's really cool. I had no idea, but this is amazing. And I'm moved. And I want to know, what are the best ways for me to make a positive impact on the work that all you people are doing right now?
Well,
just, you know, give me your wallet and I'll say thank you. you know, I think that it's kind of, again, like missionary work, right? You know, it's like, okay, well, what do the Mormons do? You know, they don't ask that question. They just go out and do it. You know, every single one of those guys trudges off to some place around the world, and they just break through it all. And a lot of those guys come back transformed, but they've also spread the word. You know, they've worked in those places to, you know, promote, I guess, what they're trying to do. Well, if we had an equal number of people doing conservation like that, you know, kind of conservation missionaries, then it would happen a lot faster, and it would, you know, we'd get the numbers up to a level that are meaningful. So, you know, I think that anyone, whatever they do in life, they just need to think, okay, how can I, you know, I've heard the story, I kind of understand the concept, so what can I do to contribute? And it depend. I mean, the answer is a billion different answers, right? So you can't just say, well, give money to the WWF. You know, that's what people usually think of, but you know, that's not what I would do. I would, you know, say, okay, this river behind my house is full of cans and it's polluted and people aren't thinking about it, and there used to be salmon here, there used to be, you know, brook trout, there used to be, so I'm gonna do this, I'm gonna do that. And if you start doing stuff like that, you know, you think about 7 billion people doing that, it would change the planet overnight.
So Mike, National Geographic has put the spotlight on Mars recently, and billions are being invested, partly with the expectation that when we use up Earth, we can always go to Mars. Would you comment?
Thank you, Sylvia.
Yeah. Yeah, Sylvia is always good for that one. I remember Sylvia once saying that if you kind of looked at the effort that's being put into exploring the deep reaches of the ocean, it would be like one Toyota Land Cruiser driving around Africa. I can't remember exactly what she said, you know, trying to save Africa, you know, kind of thing. It's, so you know, what we don't know about this planet is incredible. I mean, we had some deep water oil exploration going on a few years ago in Gabon, and I said to the Total guys, hey, can you like take your ROV and just kind of cruise around on the bottom at 1,700 meters and see if you see anything, right? And we're seeing like, you know, spider crabs like this big and tons of different fish and all, 1,700 meters, like pitch black, and the pressure is like, you know, crazy. So there's a lot of life down there, tons of life. And, you know, I think that, once again, if humans kind of recognize that the cost of getting people to Mars, even if it was habitable, which it most definitely is not right now, you know, that's just fantasy. And we've tried for decades to get out there, you know? Well, we haven't been able to do it. Yeah, we got some folks on the moon decades ago, but since then, you know, what have we done? Nothing, because it's logistically almost impossible to imagine that we could ever do that. So we've got one planet, and we need to live with it, and we need to, you know, keep it healthy. And so, yeah.
Lady back there.
Thank you so very, very much for being here. It's really inspiring, and it's so fantastic to see how you've both turned your passions into doing such impactful work. So thank you for being here, and also for bringing along Uber and along to join you. I wanted to ask, nearly 20 years later, have you been in contact with the Pygmy who, I think I'm hopefully saying that correctly, the group of men who accompanied you on your journey? Are you in contact with them? What can you tell them us about them now?
Well, one by one, it would take a long time, but actually I was just telling Nick in one of these videos, when the guys are at attention, they're singing the national anthem, two of them are in that lineup, and they're guards. There's also, I was just talking to Cricket yesterday, and she said in Gualogo, the main point man is their main guide, and his children are there. Several of them are also dead, because pygmies, they don't take care of themselves. It's very hard for them to understand that, you know, malaria can kill you, and flu can kill you, and chiggers can kill you, and, you know, alcohol can kill you, and marijuana can kill you. And so probably... probably, well, if you smoke, like, you know.
Okay.
It can kill you. But, you know, just to say that as many of those guys that were willing and able to keep in the fray, many of them are still in the fray with us. And their kids are still in the fray. But pygmies are diminishing every day, and they are a people in big trouble. There's no doubt about it.
We know that pygmy is not the proper way to call them. They're Babinjale, they're Baka, they're Bagombe, they're all kinds of names. But pygmy is the word we use to put them all into a group. But know that we don't call them that to their face.
Yeah, it's just...
One final question, please. If there is one.
I see one over there.
Yeah?
Back there. Over there.
Okay.
Oops.
Thank you. And second of all, my question is, you've mentioned the importance of natural resources in Gabon, and I was wondering how you can balance conservation of natural resources with economically benefiting from them as well. Thank you.
A small question.
Yeah. Well, you know, once again, if you're the local bank here and people come in with masks and they ask you to empty the vault and walk out with all those piles of cash.
What's going on?
And again, you say thank you. That's not a good strategy for a country, right? So everybody's got, you know, in our nation states, a lot of resources that they are allotted, I guess you'd say. And, you know, the stupidest thing you can say, do, and Teddy Roosevelt said it many, many times, you know, the thing a nation, especially a young nation, does not want to do is squander its natural resource base. Why would you want to kill all the trees for no reason? Why would you want to destroy forest productivity? Why would you want to get rid of all the, I mean, look at the white-tailed deer in this country. It's a very kind of mundane, I guess you'd say, example, but at the turn of the century, there were only about 200,000 white-tailed deer left in this country, in the entire country. And now, you know, people in Virginia look at them like they're tsetse flies. You know, there's just too many of them. They're everywhere. And what are you going to do with all these deer? Well, how did that happen? The human footprint has increased by tenfold in the eastern United States since the Civil War. And yet, you know, Virginia had zero white-tailed deer. And they've come back like crazy. And that human footprint has increased. How did we do that? How did we accomplish that? Well, we accomplished it by saying, how are we going to manage deer and let humans develop? How are we going to do that? Well, you can do that. There are methodologies for that. So that's what nations have to do. A country like Gabon can't afford to squander its natural resource base. It can't afford to let people just come in and steal everything or corrupt everyone. And governance becomes difficult just in general. Keeping order in your country becomes impossible. Civil war breaks out. So you know, it's not about depriving humans of anything. It's quite the contrary. It's delivering their future to them.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Woo.
Hey, Nikki. Thank you, sir.